Hello students, today we are going to start third session of digestive system. Till now you had learned the digestion process up to stomach. So let's revise few things about stomach. Stomach is located in our abdomen. And the wall of stomach contains so many types of digestive glands, which are known as gastric glands. They secrete gastric juice. So the components of the gastric juice are mucus, HCl or hydrochloric acid, and the enzymes. Mucus mainly protects the inner lining of the stomach from the action of proteolytic enzyme pepsin and hydrochloric acid. HCl activates the inactive pepsinogen to active pepsin and also kills the germs present in food. And HCl provides acidic medium for the action of the enzymes also. Now the enzymes pepsinogen, gastric lipase and renin for the infants. So what are the reactions occurring in the stomach? First, pepsinogen that is converted to active pepsin by the action of hydrochloric acid. Then this pepsin acts on protein molecules and converts it to peptones. And the renin that is present in the stomach of infants converts casein or milk protein to curd. The semi-solid mixture or semi-liquid also we can tell, that is mainly acidic, partly digested, which is coming from stomach to the intestine, is known as chyme. So chyme is semi-liquid and it is acidic. So today we are going to start the next organ that is related to the digestive tract, that is small intestine. It is a part of digestive tract that follows the stomach. You can see that after the stomach, the small intestine starts. It is a site where almost all the digestion and absorption of the nutrients from food takes place. This is the diagram of small intestine. You can see that this is a very coiled structure, almost 7 meter long tube. It has three distinct regions. Duodenum, that is the topmost part of the small intestine attached to the stomach. Then the middle part, that is known as jejunum. And the end part that is attached to the large intestine, that part is known as ileum. So three parts are there: duodenum, jejunum and ileum. So first we will see the duodenum. Duodenum, which is present just lower end of the stomach, just now you have seen in the diagram, it mainly receives the chyme, acidic chyme, from the stomach. You can see that this is the duodenum which is attached with the stomach, and acidic chyme is moving out from the stomach to the duodenum cavity. It also receives pancreatic juice from the pancreas. This is the pancreas, and from the pancreas, pancreatic juice is also coming to the duodenum, and it also receives the bile that is coming from the liver. This is the liver. So from the liver, bile is coming to the duodenum. Actually, bile is produced in the liver and stored in the gallbladder. This is the gallbladder. So from the liver, bile is coming and stored in the gallbladder, from where it is released to the duodenum. Next, we will discuss the functions of pancreatic juice and bile in digestion. So first is pancreatic juice, the liquid that enters small intestine from pancreas. It contains three types of enzymes, that is carbohydrate digesting, protein digesting, and also fat digesting. So first is protein digesting enzyme, that is named amylase, pancreatic amylase or amylopsin, which acts on sugars, mainly complex sugar or carbohydrate, that is starch, which is converted to the disaccharide maltose by the action of this pancreatic amylase. Now next is the digestion of protein. Trypsin and chymotrypsin, these two enzymes are there in the pancreatic juice, which act on proteins. So proteins in the presence of trypsin or chymotrypsin converted to peptones. Peptones actually are the small protein molecules. Next is lipase. It is also known as steatopsin. That is the fat digesting enzyme which acts on fat. So fats, by the action of lipase, is converted to fatty acid and glycerol. Now what is the function of bile? Bile juice doesn't contain any digestive enzymes, but it helps in the digestion. It serves mainly two functions. These two are the functions of the bile. First, bile is act as emulsifying agent. That means it breaks down fats into small pieces so that it is exposed to fat digesting enzymes easily. You can see here, this is the large molecule of fat. By the action of bile, it is converted to that small molecules. For that, the fat digesting enzymes can act easily. Next function of the bile is, bile changes the acidic medium to alkaline medium in which the enzymes can act. Actually, the chyme that is coming from the stomach is acidic in nature, but the enzymes present in the small intestine cannot act in acidic medium. So for that, bile changes the acidic medium of the environment of small intestine into the alkaline medium. For that, the enzymes can act easily. Now the partially digested food is coming to the ileum, and which is the last part of the small intestine just before the large intestine. You can see that is a wall of the ileum which contains so many intestinal glands. These all are the intestinal glands. Intestinal glands mainly secrete intestinal juice, which is also known as succus entericus. So these all are the reactions occurring by the different enzymes present in the intestinal juice. So first is the digestion of starch. Maltose, which is already produced in the small intestine by the action of pancreatic juice, it is converted to the glucose by the action of maltase. It is the enzyme which converts the maltose to glucose. Next, the lactose, which is one disaccharide, it is converted to glucose plus galactose by the action of lactase. Then the enzyme sucrase, it converts the disaccharide sucrase to glucose plus fructose. So all the disaccharides are converted to their end products by the action of the disaccharidases, which are present in the intestinal juice. So these all are the end products of the digestion of complex carbohydrates. Now the digestion of small protein molecules, peptones, which are already produced by the action of the pancreatic juice and the gastric juice on the proteins. So the small peptones is converted to peptides and amino acids by the action of erypsin, that is the protein digesting enzyme present in the intestinal juice. So this amino acid is the end product of the digestion of proteins. Last is digestion of fats. Lipase, that is the fat digesting enzyme, converts the fats into fatty acid and glycerol. So you can see that in the small intestine, all the nutrients, that is carbohydrates, protein, fats, digestion is completed and all the end products of their digestive products are formed. That is, from complex carbohydrate, glucose is formed, from the proteins, amino acid is formed, and from the fats, fatty acids and glycerol are formed. So digestion of carbohydrate, protein, fat is completed in small intestine. Small intestine also has another important function, that is absorption. When digested food is passed from digestive tract to bloodstream, food actually remains 3 to 5 hours in small intestine for digestion and absorption. So this is the inner surface of the small intestine. You can see here that so many finger like projections are present in the inner surface of the small intestine. These all are the finger like projections. These are known as villi. So this is the structure of a single villus. Villi mainly contain very thin wall for the easy absorption of the nutrients. It contains so many blood capillaries and also one lacteal or lymphatic duct, this one. Now, what are the functions of villi? First, it increases the surface area for absorption. Just now you have seen that so many blood vessels or blood capillaries are present in the villi, which transports the food into bloodstream. That means the villi helps in the absorption directly. Next is, villi contain lymph duct, which is known as lacteal. It transports fat. The undigested food that cannot be absorbed in the small intestine is passed to the large intestine. So large intestine is present just after the small intestine. It is 1.5 meter long tube and consists of three parts. What are the three parts? First part is known as cecum. This is small part, cecum. Next is long colon part. This is colon. And lastly, rectum. So cecum does not have so much of function in human being. Then also it helps in absorption of fluids and salts and makes mucus with the undigested food. You can see here that one small tail-like part is attached with that cecum. That is known as vermiform appendix. So this vermiform appendix, current theory suggests that it may have some immune function. Next is colon. It is long portion It extracts water and mineral salts from the undigested food and pass the undigested food or waste material to the rectum. Rectum is short region that acts as temporary storage of stool or the feces. After that, the waste products or the stool is removed from our body through that anus. This process is known as egestion or defecation. So from the mouth to anus, the all parts are related to the digestive tract. Now, what are the digestive glands which are associated with the digestion process? Already we had discussed all the types of digestive glands. Then also once more, here are the name of the glands and here are the secretions they secrete. So first is salivary glands, which are located in the mouth and secrete saliva. Then gastric glands, which are located in the wall of stomach and secrete gastric juice. Then liver, it is located in our abdomen and secretes bile. Then pancreas, it secretes pancreatic juice. Then intestinal glands, which are located in the wall of small intestine, which secrete intestinal juice. So this all digestive glands together with the parts of the digestive tract help in the digestion process. The absorbed nutrients are used for the different purposes of cell known as assimilation. Excess nutrients are stored in our body in various forms. Glucose is stored as glycogen, stored in liver. Fat is stored in adipose tissue, that is underlying the skin and in between the organs, and amino acids are used for the making of protoplasm in the cells. Now little bit we will talk about the irregular food habits. Irregular food habits can cause disorders in the digestion process. It can be caused mainly by taking spicy, oily or junk foods or fast foods. If you are in hurry and not chewing the food properly, that improper chewing also can cause the disorders in the digestion process. All these disorders we can prevent by the intake of healthy foods, lots of vegetables, fruits, etc. So by that, we are ending the chapter Digestive System. In our next session, we will discuss another chapter. Till then, bye and have a nice day.